Hi, we were incredibly lucky to go behind the scenes and get the full story from what I think are one of the true visionaries in the world of car design, Zenvo Automotive. This Danish company have been producing artisan hypercars for over 15 years. Jens, Zenvo Chairman and Chief Commercial Officer, is going to share all the detail on the development, the engineering and the design process involved in their latest project, the Aurora. Enjoy.
Morning, I'm Jens Sverdrup. I'm the chairman and CCO of Zenvo Automotive. Welcome here to Præstø, Denmark, coastal little fishing village about an hour south of Copenhagen, and where we have our headquarters.
Really happy you're here.
Looking forward to present to you the new beginning of Zenvo, you could say, Zenvo 2.0, and the Aurora hybrid hypercar. The first thing we wanted to do when we developed it was to sort of set a philosophy. And it's not about setting lap records. It's all about having what I call balance of performance. Just have like this sweet spot. We want the best possible driver's cars. You know, smile per mile is something that's always on our blackboard.
So I can't tell you how happy I am with what you see here.
Pretty early on, you know, we made a choice to go with hybrid solutions because, you know, we're making powertrains that should be good for meeting worldwide emission standards, basically beyond 2035. Having said that, I also see a future with us using e-fuels. It also gives us like an incredible performance advantage. We have a better throttle response than you could ever have on a normally aspirated engine, let's face it. We have developed a gearbox which has a hybrid system included in it, which I think it's, if not world first, is definitely unique.
Yeah.
Hello.
How's things?
Yeah.
All good?
Yeah.
You haven't broken it yet?
I wanted to make sure it's something that is deeply rooted in something that the market actually wanted. Lo and behold, everybody wants a V12, of course. It's the most emotional like sound and feeling of any engine out there. So it's been a dream of mine in every project I've been involved with in the past. And well, any petrol head loves a V12, right? Probably 150 years ago or 130 years ago or whatever it is, when the car came out, everyone thought that horses would be extinct. And of course, there's more horses now than there's ever been. The car never took over. It moved from transport to recreation. It's an expression of a person's personality, much like a yacht or a house is.
How's it going?
Good.
Oh, good.
Yeah. Prototype Aurora
intake. Ah, cool. That's cool. It started with an idea that Christian Brandt, our head of design, came to me and said, hey, you know, Jens, we have this idea about, you know, modularity. And the first thing I saw was literally just some sketches of a monocoque, basically, which made me really intrigued. It's like, okay, this is actually really smart. So let's see if we can take this further. So I think the first thing I came, okay, we have to make the design more Danish, you know. Very quickly, we realized we have to have our own engine because of the packaging, basically. It's narrow, the car. What else can we do? Well, I guess if we make the engine modular, we can also develop potentially V10s, V8s, and V6s, which sort of makes the investment into an all-new V12 worth it long-term.
I've been talking quite a lot about design language and philosophy, so I think it's time to meet Christian Brandt, our head of design.
Hi, Jens.
Hi, Christian.
Hey, man. Good to see you.
Good to see you, too.
How did the philosophy come about? To what's behind the Aurora design language?
It's very much sort of almost a homage to this Danish design heritage. And it's the form follows function. That is for sure one of the pillars. The execution between the two cars is, of course, very, very different, because on the Giel, we're very much focusing on this, you know, the track performance, the high downforce that you can do very quick cornering. Whereas the Tour is the high speed car, so the whole aerodynamic conditions around that car is completely different. I really didn't want to do a new car that was just sort of, quote, another supercar, you know, another sort of monolithic shape. Yeah. So when you came on board and we started to have these discussions, you know, it was interesting that fell completely in line with the thoughts that you had been having.
Yeah.
And Arne Jacobsen has been a fantastic inspiration for the project, because that idea about form follows function, but also that sculptural approach, which I think these chairs are a very good example of, was a fantastic inspiration for a car.
Even when we designed the interior of the car, you know, there was this desire to feel like you were part of a sculpture.
I think there's been a tendency to sort of maximalism in cars like Bentley, Rolls-Royce, others would do. You know, they would try to squeeze in so many little details on seats and interior trims and stuff like that. So you're just trying to get so much in there as possible, which it was quite interesting to dial it the other way. We really wanted to try to do something just with one piece of leather, extremely simple.
As simple as it sounds, it is actually much harder to do.
Yes. We have leather in the interiors. We have real carbon fiber in the interiors. We have machined aluminum parts, which basically starts as a block of aluminum, which is machined and hand polished and stuff like that. So everywhere you look and touch, the materials you see are actually genuinely high quality materials, which is something which is really a luxury in the car business, where you normally would have to use plastics everywhere for keeping the price down. And what we tried to do with this very, very open design, where you can look through the bodywork and see the suspension components, both front and rear, is this play between the sculptural surfaces and then the mechanical components. I'm usually referencing, you know, sort of skeleton watches that has a bit that same. You have a beautiful housing, and then you have all the cogs and wheels that are turning inside.
Yeah.
We basically constructed the car like a Formula One car. So you have the center, wheels are coming off, and then we just added these sort of fender parts that is just basically there to guide the wind, but also to make sure that this car is road legal.
So a more mass-produced car, you know, you'll get away with, you know, just covering up, let's face it, you know, ugly parts. But for us, you know, beauty really starts from within, you know, and it has to be the best quality everything.
The experience of going through the speccing process and coming here to the factory and seeing the car being built, it's as much a part of the product as the final car, right?
Yeah. Hey, Simon. How's it going?
Always.
That's good. What are you doing?
Doing the shapes, what they kind of call them.
Ah, it's the speed forms. Ah, cool. How are you doing?
Good.
I think everything is equally hard, right? You know, everything is... Nothing is easy. So, yeah. Developing an engine is hard. Building it is hard because of the precision. You know, painting a car is hard. If you're gonna get to this sort of exceptional level, it is really, really hard. If you're always trying your best, you improve every day, right? No matter what you do. So you become better and better and better at the art of building a car, basically. So that's what the guys are doing. And looking forward to see more than this part. You know, I want to see the whole car. So we're now entering the Zenvo production facilities, and I have a dear old colleague of mine here, Dr. Thomas Johansson, who's our head of powertrains. The Aurora project is like, I don't know how many times I've said it today, but it's every single nut and bolt and everything is brand new. So,
And I remember we talked about this, what is the dream engine for the customers? And we always come back to it's a V12.
Yeah. What is behind our innovation as opposed to maybe other projects you've been involved with?
We are a little bit spoiled in this hypercar business because we don't need to focus on cost so much. We can take this next level on materials, on the way how to simulate things. Mm-hmm. And a natural solution with combustion engine is to have some hybrid powertrains.
I hear a lot of people go, yeah, you can't beat the throttle response of a naturally aspirated engine, blah, blah, blah. That's not true. You can't beat the response of electrification, actually.
No.
So that's, we're taking an already really responsive engine, basically, and adding even more response to it by using the hybrid technology. For me, as a driver, that's a really good thing.
Really want this engine noise or sound to really be part of this experience. And since this type of car is a really luxury, because we can decide if we go electrical or going quiet, and then we can be kind of loud if you go on a track or something like that.
That is something a lot of our customers ask of.
If you're looking at the combustion engine of the Aurora car, then we are also taking an extra step on the combustion efficiency that we're having, meaning that we have a really high expansion ratio and good efficiency and low emissions. So we have the opportunity to both improve the combustion engine and also with these new electrical motors and the integrated inverters with the motors, we got a really nice package. No one really needs the kind of performance we are looking for, but we are showing the way for the future, maybe, that can inspire and the technology can trickle down. And we saw that when we started with carbon fiber like 20 years ago, right. Nowadays it's a common feature in ordinary sports cars.
Yep.
So the solutions we are able to do today is something that can be on everyday cars in the future.
Yeah.
Starting with the toughest thing you can do today, a new V12, a new hybrid powertrain, a new chassis and a car platform.
Yeah.
Everything after this is going to be easier.
This is the autoclave we're using for example, big body panels like your hood, you know, our monocoques, etc. So that would be in this. We're obviously going to need more of them as we enter production for the Aurora. What do you see is the biggest challenge, you know, of this project?
That's maybe the problem. I don't see it as a challenge. I see it as an opportunity to really taking current technology one step ahead, and maybe it is a challenge, but it should be.
Yeah.
But that's not the way many of us thinking, because we've been doing this kind of challenging projects before. Let's say business as usual.
It's like climbing the Mount Everest. It used to be impossible. Then one guy did it, and now there's like a traffic jam up there, right? Yeah. You know, it has been since the first guy did it. It became possible. If you're in the UK, you have all the suppliers, literally up the M4 corridor. And if you're in Italy, you have this sort of a motorsport valley. We don't have it on our doorstep. It actually makes more sense to do it ourselves. So I think that's where you see like brands like us, we end up doing more insourcing, basically. If we can do it faster, better, cheaper ourselves, then that's your answer. So that's the end of the factory tour. I'm really grateful you could come. In a little while, I wish you can come back again and see a full hive of activities here as the Auroras get built, and we hopefully hit our deadlines before Goodwood Festival of Speed in July, where you'll see and hear the Auroras going up the hill July. See you then.